now broken down in Jesus. And though we are still different, He makes us one. No one better than another. We all need faith in Jesus, for only He can save us. He makes us one. We are yours, we belong, every daughter, every son. We are one, we're the family of God. Rich and poor, old and young, every nation, every tongue. We are one, we're the family of God. We were dead in sin and helpless, now made alive in Jesus. He purchased our forgiveness.
So good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to the fourth Sunday of Eastertide, which in the church calendar is Good Shepherd Sunday. And on the colloquial calendar, today is Mother's Day. So thank you for joining us this morning, for gathering together to support, encourage, and pray for one another, and to come together as one to lift up our voices, to lift up our hearts in prayer and praise. A couple of announcements. This Tuesday morning, we are going to have a spring cleanup day. So there is a role for everybody. There is something for everybody to do. So we're going to begin at 9:30, and you are all welcome to come and help. There's little things and big things and priorities and less priorities, but something for everyone. But most of all, a time of fellowship and laughter. So come and join us, and we'll get everything shipshape for spring as we open up our cafe next week. I want to begin this morning recognizing both the joy and the grief that can be felt on this Mother's Day. I want to read a piece by Amy Young, and then I'm going to invite Miss Bess to come and light the blue candle of mourning for those who are grieving today. To those who gave birth this year to their first child, we celebrate with you. To those who have lost a child, we mourn with you. To those who are in the trenches with little ones every day and wear the badge of food stains, we appreciate you. To those who experience loss through miscarriage, stillbirth, failed adoptions, or running away, we mourn with you. To those who walk the hard path of infertility, fraught with pokes, prods, tears, and disappointment, we walk with and pray for you. To those who are foster moms, mentor moms, and spiritual moms, we need you. To those who have warm and close relationships with your children, we celebrate with you. To those who have disappointment, heartache, and distance with your children, we sit with you. To those who lost their mothers this year, we grieve with you. To those who have experienced abuse at the hands of your own mother, we acknowledge your experience. To those who live through driving tests, medical tests, and the overall testing of motherhood, we are better for having you in our midst. To those who have aborted children, we remember them and you on this day. To those who are single and long to be married and mothering your own children, we mourn that life has not turned out the way you long for it to be. To those who step-parent, we journey with you on these complex paths. To those who envisioned lavishing love on grandchildren, yet that dream is not to be, we grieve with you. To those who will have emptier nests in the upcoming year, we grieve and rejoice with you. To those who place children up for adoption, we commend you for your selflessness and remember how you hold that child in your heart. And to those who are pregnant with new life, both expected and surprising, we anticipate with you. This Mother's Day, we pray for you. Mothering is not for the faint of heart, and we have real warriors in our midst. We honor you. I invite Miss Bess to come now and light the blue candle of grief. Would you pray with me? You are our shepherd, O Lord. As we follow you, bless us with all good things that we may be refreshed and bring about refreshing. Deliver us from the troubles, temptations, worries, and cares that seek to ensnare us, so that we may always do what is pleasing in your sight and remain safe in the care of our good shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm going to invite Miss Mary to come now and read a poem that she wrote for Mother's Day.
A card to my mother. Today is Mother's Day, when we honor all women in our lives who have loved, cared, and nurtured us unselfishly. One such woman who comes to my mind is my mother. My mother was born in 1906. She was married in 1926. She raised 10 children, and 5 she raised all on her own after my dad died. She was our rock, our glue that held our family together. Anchored by her quiet inner strength, her faith, her trust in God, she instilled in us the foundations of our faith, not only in her words, but her actions towards us and others. She made the church the center of our family life. Even though times were tough, she and we celebrated life. The nightly table, dinner table, rocked with laughter, teasing, stories, concern, and sometimes even advice.
We gathered together.
My mother just
in the
sat at the head of the table
God.
And just smiled. Christmas was
who
especially memorable.
Our souls.
First celebrated by Christmas Eve Mass, then gifts in the morning.
And love never
we would
stops
all line up in
us.
The stairs, from the oldest to the youngest, to run down the stairs to see what gifts we got. And then came loads and loads and loads of holiday food. My mother just smiled, for she just loved to have her children around her. She wanted the best for us five, even though she was not well educated. Her keen interest in our schooling encouraged us to do our best and be the best we could. Her tireless, unselfish sacrifice impacted our lives and influenced us to be who we are today. When I think of my mother, my eyes welled up in tears. I miss her so much. Our talks, our luncheons, our shopping trips, and laughter. But most of all, I miss her loving smile and her loving touch. My mother died on August 24, 1994, after a long battle of Alzheimer's disease. She was surrounded by her family, her children, her grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. She left a legacy to our family of service and sacrifice that I know that I could never, ever match. A truly remarkable, amazing woman. My mother, my friend, my hero. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. You will always be in my heart.
Join me now as we do the responsive reading that appears on our screen. So this is a poem by Komal Matthew, for the shepherd who is also the path the sun makes in daytime. A good shepherd is a wonder in contrapposto, an artist mapping the Serengeti with kingdom lines. A good shepherd angles a lion's eye, traps gazelles in dry fields, copies a cheetah's spots one leg at a time. A good shepherd does not give you stones when you ask for toast, does not ask you to work without a burning bush, but owns a gate, uses a gate, pulls the weeds and leaves the wheat on an altar of choices. A good shepherd is a prince of peace when terror finds its full echo, a creator in the wild, where a predator providentially becomes prey. We are going to continue in worship through song. So I invite you to stand or sit, to kneel, to clap, to dance, however the Spirit leads you.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near, and I won't fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I?
Oh no, we never let go. Through the calm and through the Acts 9:36-43. Now in Joppa there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time, she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydia was near Joppa, the disciples who heard that Peter was there sent two men to him with the request, "Please come with to us without delay." So Peter got up and went with him, and when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put all of them outside, and then he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, get up." Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner.
Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. God, I see your grace is enough, and I'm covered in your love.
Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the right paths for his namesake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Good shepherd of my soul, come dwell within me. Take all I am and mold your likeness in me. Before the cross of Christ, this is my sacrifice. A life laid down and ready to follow. The troubled find their peace in true surrender. The prisoners their release from chains of anger. In springs of living grace, I find a resting place to rise refreshed, determined to follow. I walk this narrow road with Christ before me, where thorns and thistles grow and cords ensnare me. Though doubted and denied, he never leaves my sight, but lifts my head and calls me to follow. And when my days are gone, my strength is failing, he'll carry me along through death's unveiling. Earth's struggles overcome, heaven's journey just begun, to search Christ's steps and ever to follow. To search Christ's steps and ever to follow.
After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one who knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat,
for the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, all words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me by his own hand, he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still 'tis his hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me by his own hand, he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee. Since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me by his own hand, he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me.
At the time the feast of the dedication took place in Jerusalem, it was winter, and Jesus was walking into the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hears my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I will give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, in regards to what he has given me, is greater than all, and no one can snatch them out of the hand of the Father. The Father and I are one."
Rich and poor alike, listen with your own heart. His love is for us all. His love is for us all. Oh, rich and poor alike, listen with your own souls. Do not live in fear, and do not live in fear. Oh, rich and poor alike, his love is for us all.
The Lord has heard the prayers that you have spoken, the praises that you have lifted up. God also knows the things that we struggle to speak out loud. And know that God is with you. God is already at work. And as you continue to seek his face, he will bring you through the valleys, to green pastures and still waters. Will you pray with me? Good Shepherd, thank you for all that you lead us through and to. Thank you for family. And Lord, we sit in the tension of those who have had experiences of motherhood that have been positive and reasons to rejoice, and those who have had experiences of motherhood that have been heartbreaking and grief-filled. And we rejoice with those who rejoice, and we mourn with those who mourn, and we lift them all up to you, God. And we thank you that you are the mother who loves us perfectly, who, like a mother hen, takes us under your wing and protects us, that you hold us close to your bosom, that you nurture us and you care for us as a perfect, loving mother would. God, your heart breaks when the hearts of your children are hurting. And we pray for healing for those who are suffering physical infirmity and sickness. We think of Miss Gale. We think of Judy and Mark. We pray for continued healing for Miss Eileen's eyes and Miss Sue's eyes. We think of Johnny and his health, ongoing health issues, and George's ongoing health issues. Lord, we pray for those who are battling diabetes. And we pray that you would help them, especially the type 1 diabetics, to keep their sugars regulated. Lord, we pray. We pray for those who are dealing with addictions, who are tempted, and God, are giving it all they have to resist those temptations. Help them to flee. Help them to stand strong. Help them to be set free from this bondage that enslaves them, that they might know in greater measure the abundant life that you have planned and prepared for them. We pray for those who are battling mental illness, God. We pray for those who are dealing with anxiety, depression, suicidal ideation, bipolar, schizophrenia. Lord, you know the world we live in, and you know all the things that are crippling us. Things we haven't even begun to recognize the consequences of, and how it alters our mind and our bodies and our spirits. And God, I pray for your protection. I pray for clarity. I pray for wisdom. But most of all, I pray for shalom, for wholeness, for healing, for each and every one, God. Body, mind, spirit, and soul, integrated as one and whole, Lord God, for each person. Help us, God. Help us to know what it is to walk in your will and walk in your ways, that we might experience more of that shalom, more of that wholeness, more of that integration. Lord, I pray for this church, and I thank you for this beautiful motley crew. I thank you for this faithful family. I thank you for their generosity of spirit, the way that they give of their time and their talents and their resources to minister without ever being asked. I thank you for the ways they support and care for one another, uplift one another, encourage one another. And Lord, help us to see what you are calling us into in these next seasons. What does it look like for us to minister well in this place you have brought us? We don't want to go to church, God. We want to be the church. We don't want to come and be entertained. We want to come and be equipped to do the work of your kingdom. We want to come that we might be enabled to see your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We come because all things aren't right in us. And we want to be more like you. We come because all things aren't right in this world. And we want it to be transformed. And we know that you work in and through us to those ends, that you have called us to partner with Christ in his mission of restoration and reconciliation of all things. So show us, each one here today, individually, show us where you are calling us into restoring work and reconciling work. Each one here, God, you've called each one into the work of restoration and the work of reconciliation. Show each of us, give us clarity what that looks like for us. As we enter into your word this morning, give us ears to hear, a mind to understand, a heart to receive, and above all else, the boldness and courage to live out what the Holy Spirit is prompting us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. So hello again on this fourth Sunday of Eastertide. The Sunday that we celebrate Mother's Day, and thank you so much for your testimonies of praise. Thank you so much for being vulnerable and authentic in what you have shared and how you ministered to us in that vulnerability. This is also, as I mentioned earlier, Good Shepherd Sunday. And as such, this morning, we are going to focus our attention on the one who restores, provides, sacrificed, and guides and protects us, our Good Shepherd. We are going to fix our gaze this morning on Christ. I think it does us some good to be reminded time and again that the gospel, the good news, is not first and foremost about what we do, but rather about what Christ has already done for us. It is not as much about morality or behavior modification, but about God, who took on human flesh, who suffered like us, was vulnerable like us, but as the Christ, as God, redeems, provides, and protects us. My prayer on this Good Shepherd Sunday is that whether you have heard a message about Jesus as the Good Shepherd before, or even many times before, that your spirit would be captivated anew by Christ in a meaningful way that does its transforming work in your spirit. That you leave here understanding on an even deeper level the goodness and greatness of our Good Shepherd. And that this understanding will lead you into deeper relationship with God, and in doing so, that you will indeed be transformed by his unending grace, the power of his example, and his unconditional sacrificial love for you. Each of the lectionary readings that you heard this morning reveal a quality or a characteristic of Christ as our Good Shepherd. And we're going to focus mostly on John's Gospel, but we will touch on Christ as revealed as our Shepherd in Acts 9, Psalm 23, and Revelation 7. In John chapter 10, verses 1 to 18, Jesus the Christ refers to himself as a good shepherd, saying, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." Jesus is our good shepherd. I want us this morning to focus on Christ, who he is and what he means when he proclaims himself to be the good shepherd. Because it's as we get this fuller understanding, not just in our minds, but in our hearts, of the goodness and greatness of Christ, that we come to love him more dearly and follow him more nearly. It's when we know, when we experience the love and care and call of Christ, that our life will become less and less about what we do and more about for whom we do it. from an overflow of the heart, a heart of worship and adoration for Jesus, our lives will be transformed. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. Whenever Jesus says, I am, we should pause and take note. I am, ego eimi, is the same translation used to describe the God of the Old Testament. Same word God used when he responded to Moses saying, I am that I am. So when Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, it is the same as what God is referred to in the Old Testament, how God refers to himself in response to Moses. I am that I am. By saying I am, or using the term ego eimi, Jesus is clearly declaring his divinity, that he is God. And he follows with the good shepherd. I am, so God, the good shepherd. Each of those three words, the good shepherd, are significant. The, because Christ was not a good shepherd, but the good shepherd. Shepherd above all shepherds. He was good when others were not so good. When others were leading the proverbial street sheep away. Now, most of us won't have any personal or very practical understanding of what it is to be a shepherd. Back then, though, in ancient Near Eastern culture, in Jesus' day, everyone listening as Christ spoke, as he referred to himself as a good shepherd, understood the significance of that role, of that title. The ancient Israelites were a shepherding people. In fact, many of their ancestors, many of our biblical heroes were shepherds. Abraham and Jacob, the 12 tribes and Moses, King David and the prophet Amos. Shepherd was an illustration, that an object lesson that accurately and clearly described Jesus, and one that would have resonated with his listeners in a deeply profound way. The ancient shepherds had a difficult but extremely important job. They led the flock to water and to pasture land. They protected them from predators, from other animals, and they found them when they strayed. Before the words that we heard this morning from John chapter 10, verses 2 to 30, there were the words of Jesus leading up to it, verses 1 to 18. And those verses paint this beautiful self-portrait of Jesus as a good shepherd, who knows us intimately and holds us in his arms. He calls us like a good shepherd does, by name. He does not, like a thief or a robber, try to steal or manipulate our hearts. No, he enters our hearts when and as we invite him to. Followers of Christ recognize his voice and are able to distinguish it apart from all other voices. Jesus, our good shepherd, the good shepherd, goes before us, not only guiding us, but looking out for our welfare. And so here again, we come to verse 27. And Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. The sheep hear my voice. I know them. Not they know me. I know them. Think about that for a moment. Christ knows you. The good shepherd knows those entrusted to him. Verse 14, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. To know someone biblically is more than just knowing someone's name or a few facts about them. It denotes a deep intimacy, Jesus completely knows us. Jesus knew Peter's heart. Even though Peter denied him three times, Jesus knew Peter's heart. Jesus knew his motivations. Jesus knew Peter's fears, his doubts, his anxieties. Jesus didn't ask Peter, "Do you love me?" three times, because Jesus was unsure about it, because Jesus was insecure. Jesus knew Peter. He asked Peter, "Do you love me?" in order that the shame that Peter was holding in his heart, that guilt, that the Good Shepherd could set him free from that, because he knew his heart, that he could set him free from that snare that he had gotten him into, that snare that Peter, that bush that Peter had gotten himself ensnared in could be set free from it, that briar bush of shame. Have you ever felt tangled up in a briar bush of shame? Jesus knows our heart, and he comes seeking to set us free. He wanted to restore Peter to wholeness. The one who truly knows us can restore us to wholeness. The one who knows us can restore us to wholeness. Can I say that one more time and you take it home? The one who knows us can restore us to wholeness. As the Good Shepherd, Jesus was guiding Peter into greater freedom and into his calling. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Shepherd with me. Partner with me. Jesus knows us. And it's because he knows us that he was willing to endure the suffering, the torture, and the death that we exposed him to. He did not suffer and die on a cross for a bunch of strangers. He died for us. He died for you. He knows us, our deepest, darkest selves. And in there, Jesus recognizes something worth dying for, something worth redeeming. Think on that. Jesus revealed in laying down his own life that there is something in us, something in you and me, something in humanity worth dying for. Christ sees something that sometimes I fail to see in myself and in humanity. He sees something worth dying for. God's most beloved creation. It was for the sake of humanity. It was for the sake of God's beloved creation. He said, "Yes, it is good. It is very good. And it is worth dying for." Christ is willing to suffer and die so that we might have life. A life redeemed, a life set free, a life increasingly transformed. And we experience this more abundant life as we come to know Christ more. To know his voice by knowing his teachings, his example, and by trusting the leading of the Holy Spirit. By drawing closer to Jesus, becoming more like him as we follow him, as we walk in his will and ways. And it is in this knowing, it is through this intimate relationship that our hearts are transformed. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. To follow Jesus means that the Good Shepherd is leading. Or guiding us. To follow Jesus means that the Good Shepherd is leading us. And we live in a society that is competing for followers, figuratively and quite literally. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all gluttons for followers. Brands want followers. Politicians battle for followers. Churches and denominations are looking for followers. We are all being led by someone or something. You are being led by someone or something. So it is good to get a sense of where they are going to lead you. Jesus invites us to follow him. And we get a sense of where that leads from the testimonies printed on the pages of Scripture, from the Old Testament through to the New. In Acts, we see, as was read this morning, where following Jesus led Peter. It led him to the same mission of restoration and reconciliation that Jesus had. Peter followed Jesus right down to the miracle of raising a dead Tabitha to life. As we follow Jesus into wholeness, we contribute to the restoration of others. Let me say that again. As we follow Jesus into wholeness, we contribute to the restoration of others. Want to know where following Jesus leads? Consider the personal poetic testimony offered in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies and anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Interesting. As we follow the leading of Jesus, what follows us is goodness and mercy. As we follow Jesus, what follows us is goodness and mercy. Jesus knows us, which means he knows the territory of our lives. He knows its dangers, its temptations. Jesus knows the great meadows, the steep precipices, the seasons and possibilities of our lives. So Jesus, our good shepherd, can lead us through it all. Jesus has gone ahead of us, but is still as close as our very breath. He is tenderly guiding us to greener pastures and refreshing waters. He holds the young in faith close to his chest or puts them up on his shoulders. And when those of us who have been walking in faith for some time grow weary, Jesus carries us. And as I was preparing this message and as I wrote this sentence, literally as I typed that sentence out, I had this vivid image immediately come to my mind, and it made me a little verklempt. And I won't soon forget that image. This image of Jesus carrying the weary faithful. I pictured Jesus carrying us in the same fashion he carried his cross. Our left arm outstretched over his shoulder, held by his hand. His right arm around our waist, holding us up, lifting us up, bearing our weight as he leads us. It's an image I won't soon forget. Where is Jesus, our good shepherd, leading us? To life abundant and life eternal. He is recorded in John 10, chapter 10, saying, I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. Jesus is leading, though sometimes we're prone to wander. We are tempted by the promises of others who are seeking to gain their own followers. The tendency of our human nature is to put ourselves in harm's way. But even then, the good shepherd comes looking for us. The parable of the lost sheep reminds us that when one wanders, when one goes off course, when we get ensnared, Christ, the Good Shepherd, goes searching for them, and when they are found and set free, there is much rejoicing. And yet there are also times, the scriptures and our own experience can testify, that even when we are being faithful, when we are following the Good Shepherd, we can still face attack from predators both inside and outside our midst. When it comes to fighting spiritual battles, temptations, powers and principalities, and the systems of oppression and injustice that want to keep us ensnared, we're not equipped to fight our own battles. We can't do it alone. And in these moments, we rely on our Good Shepherd who protects us. Jesus says, no one will snatch them. That is us. No one will snatch them. No one will snatch us, his followers, out of his hand. We are safe in the hands of Jesus. The closer we are to Christ, the safer we are. The closer we are to Christ, the safer we are. Once again, it does not mean that we will not experience persecution or injustice, trials or tribulation, grief or loss, but that Christ will be with us and Christ will protect us, not allowing it to overtake us. Amen. Our great shepherd assures us, saying, my Father, in regard to what he has given, is greater than all, and no one, not one thing, nothing, can snatch them out of the Creator's hand. The safest place to be is in the grip of God. The safest place to be is in the grip of God. Christ, our Good Shepherd, will hold us strong, steady us, and lead us out of the valley, restoring us to the plains and the mountaintops once again. Jesus is willing to protect us to the point of sacrificing his life for us. Jesus gave up his life to protect us from death. In verse 26, Jesus says, I gave them eternal life and they will never perish. Peter's work of restoration that we heard from Acts 9 is a work of God, but it is only a temporary work. Tabitha, or Dorcas, as her friends like to call her, is still going to die an earthly death. It is only the sacrificial work of Christ himself that can restore us unto life everlasting. Which brings us to the final and most important characteristic of Christ, our Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sake of each and every one. Three times in chapter 10 of the book of John, leading up to today's lectionary passage, Jesus talks about laying down his life. Verse 11, I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Verse 15, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. And verse 17, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I might take it back up again. I love this role reversal that we're seeing here. If you recall from the Old Testament, it was always the sheep that was sacrificed for the shepherd. But now the Good Shepherd dies for the sheep. Do you see the reversal? The shepherd will sacrifice himself for those who are precious to him. And the difference is relationship. The difference is relationship. With the hired hand, it's a me and them relationship. With religion, it can become only about what we can get. With Christ, it is always a me and mine relationship. His only interest being what he can give. And so he gave up his life, taking upon himself our sins, the sins of the world, and transforming the most vile act of power-mongering injustice and hate into the greatest act of love and forgiveness the world has ever and will ever witness. He gave up his life so that we might have life abundantly and eternally. As we consider these things, all that is being unveiled in our Revelation study should come back to mind. How Jesus did not protect us by violently attacking the enemy. He did not claim victory by bringing death to others, but rather by his own surrendering to death at our violent hearts, at our violent hands. His power was not that of the sword, but his greatest power was vulnerability. This is the victory being celebrated in Revelation chapter 7, as we heard BJ read today. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in hand, palm branches, symbols of victory. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." Who is celebrating with him? Who, as the elders asked, are these robed in white, and where have they come from? These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb, the sacrificial Lamb, the Lamb that we nailed to a cross, will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. He says, "I gave them eternal life, and they will never perish." This should give us confidence and peace. God's got us in this life and in the life to come. In the midst of all we are facing, whatever has us ensnared, Christ knows. He knows even if it's a trap of our own making or a snare of the enemy. Christ knows. And you are worth dying for. Christ knows. And he is with you, leading you into greater wholeness, protecting you along the way, providing you what you need, those proverbial green pastures of nourishment and still waters of refreshment and rest. We simply need to trust Christ enough to follow him. We can spend a lifetime learning about Jesus. A lot of people do. We can follow diligently every checklist for Christian living, religiously partake of the spiritual disciplines, but as the old cliche goes, it's about relationship, not religion. The power is in the relationship, in knowing Christ, hearing his voice, following his example, his teaching, and his leading. So as we close this morning, I want you to ask yourself something. How well do you know the Good Shepherd? Consider this. Two men were called on in a large classroom to recite the 23rd Psalm. One was a published orator trained in speech, technique, and drama. He repeated the psalm in a powerful way. When he finished, the audience cheered and even asked for an encore that they might hear this wonderful voice again. Then the other man, who was much older, repeated the same words. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." But when he finished, no sound came from the large class. Instead, people sat in a deep mood of devotion and prayer. Then the first man, the orator, stood to his feet. "I have a confession to make," he said. "The difference between what you have just heard from my old friend and what you heard from me is this. I know the psalm. My friend knows the shepherd." Do you know the Good Shepherd? How deeply, how intimately do you know the Good Shepherd? Your answer to that question will make all the difference in grabbing hold of that promise of abundant life. There's an old hymn, and we're going to sing it as our closing song today, that remains one of my favorites, titled Softly and Tenderly. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Do you recognize his voice? Have you allowed yourself to draw close enough, near enough to hear him? If you are hearing God's voice this morning and he is calling you to himself, then I simply implore you to turn to him and trust him. Surrender to the Good Shepherd and allow him to give you new life, wholeness, restoration, reconciliation, your calling. And perhaps you've been following all the Christian practices, but your heart has been dulled, lifeless, stagnant, because this Christian life has become all about what you're needing to do rather than who he is and what he has done and is doing. And then again, I implore you to turn and to trust in Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd, to be still by those waters, to rest in that green pasture and know that he is God, the one who knows you, and allow him once again to care for you, to take control. Can I say that again? Allow God to care for you and to take control, to lead, feed, correct, and protect you. I'd encourage you this morning to focus your heart's attention not so much on your Christian checklist or to-do list, but to focus your heart on the voice of Christ and simply allow his Spirit to fill you. And in doing so, may you see your life transformed through a heart of worship. Let us pray. We thank you, Good Shepherd. We thank you for the ways you have led and are leading us. Help us to follow closely, that the dust of your sandals might get on us. Help us to walk in your will and ways, that we might reflect more of the image of Christ to those around us. Help us to follow you so closely that we reflect you brilliantly, to follow you so nearly that we can hear the whisper of your Spirit speaking to us, inviting us into our calling, guiding us and leading us to green pastures and still waters, holding us and carrying us through the valleys. Thank you, Good Shepherd, for the ways that you know us. You know us. You know every foible, every flaw, every sin. And yet, you considered us worth dying for. You know every lie. You know every truth. You know every gift. You know every blemish. We are worth it. We are worthy of your love. We are worthy of your sacrifice. Help us to see you and then to see ourselves through your eyes, God. Your child, worthy and loved unconditionally. And may that love lead us to trust you unconditionally. As you call us softly and tenderly, may we hear your voice and respond in trust, repentance, and truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand as we close and worship through song.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching. watching for you and for me.
Peace of the Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storms. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he's shown. May he bring you home rejoicing once again through these doors. Go knowing you are led by the good shepherd. Amen.
Us one.